Hey everybody, thanks for watching this video. I'm Zach Peterson, I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're going to talk about PCB laminate materials and specifically what information you need to know from a laminate material datasheet. Now, if you look at a datasheet for PCB substrate materials, there's a lot of information in there. Some of it is only relevant for manufacturers, and some of it is more relevant for you as a designer. So as a designer, it's your job to know what information is really important and how to call that information out when you're creating your stack up in your PCB design software. So there's a lot of stuff to get through. Let's get started. When you're looking for materials to use in your PCB stack up, there are a few things that you can consider. So first, if you take some initiative and call your fabricator, at the beginning of the design, you'll actually find out what materials they have available, and you can probably get them to send you the data sheets, and that can help you narrow down to a specific stack up. Sometimes you can just tell them, hey, I need a 4-layer stack up, what's your standard stack up? And they'll send it to you, and you can go off of that. And if you're just building kind of a vanilla board, maybe it doesn't have high voltage, maybe it doesn't have super high speed components, that's usually gonna be just fine. Put it on a 4-layer board and get started. If you're doing something that might be a little more advanced, or maybe it's operating at higher voltages, maybe it's running at higher powers, maybe you're using multiple high-speed components, there are some other important points to consider in data sheets. So I want to go over those material properties now. So first, material property to consider in your data sheet. And we actually talked a little bit about this in a previous video on thermal resistance, but it's actually the thermal conductivity. So the thermal conductivity tells you how fast heat can be dissipated away from a hot area of a board and into a cold area of a board, okay? Your typical thermal conductivity value for FR4 is, you could call it mid-range. If you're not running at super high powers, maybe you're not running at higher temperature, you are not necessarily looking at thermal conductivity so much. But let's say you're developing for a lighting application. So industrial lighting is a great example. If you're developing for a lighting application, thermal conductivity actually becomes really important. And this is one of the reasons that boards used for lighting applications and for lighting equipment are usually metal core boards. So they'll have an aluminum layer in the core, and that's in order to provide a layer with very high thermal conductivity. And that layer will pull heat away from the LEDs and the power regulators that you have on that board. Our company's actually done power regulators for an underwater sub, and that power regulator, we used a metal core board for precisely that reason. It's running underwater, and I know that, you know, it's 30-something degrees Celsius down there in deep water. However, when you have a lot of lights and a power regulator on this board, it's still going to generate a lot of heat. And so using a metal core board provides high thermal conductivity to pull that that heat away. Another important thermal property is the glass transition temperature. I'll just write glass transition temp. And usually if you look in the data sheet, this is denoted with the symbol TG. So TG values vary anywhere from about 130 Celsius up to maybe 170, 180 Celsius, depending on the manufacturer. And so some laminate materials, they will call this out or market it as a low TG material. They will call this a high TG material. Actually very important for thermal expansion. So you don't always need to know the thermal expansion coefficient from the data sheet directly. What's actually more important is the glass transition temperature. And the glass transition temperature tells you when the board will start expanding very quickly as it heats up. That's important because it puts a lot of stress on any vias that are in your board. And under extreme conditions where you have a lot of expansion, and you have very thin plating on your vias, it can actually fracture via walls. This is also important if you're in like an HDI board, so it's a bit more of an advanced board, but if you're working in the HDI regime and you're using micro vias, the neck on that via can actually fracture also under extreme temperature or extreme expansion at high temperatures. So TG is very important. In general, you would like to choose a TG value that is above the projected operating temperature of your board. For high reliability applications, high TG is gonna be your entry level. If it's just a one-off or a test board, or you know it's always gonna be running at room temperature, you're fine with low TG, because you're generally gonna be at under 130 Celsius. This is really important also for cycling. So when I say cycling, I mean temperature cycling. You heat the board up, it cools down. You heat the board up, it cools down. And every time you heat the board up above the glass transition temperature, those vias get stressed and they eventually will fatigue and they can eventually fracture and then your board fails. So this is essentially the glass transition temperature is really important for reliability. The next important material property that you can get out of data sheets is more important for high speed design, which is usually denoted DF for dissipation factor or loss tangent. Okay. And these two values are sometimes used interchangeably. Rarely you will see DF used to denote the complex portion or the imaginary portion of the dielectric constant. What's more important though is loss tangent. This is a more important term because it's generally used by most people in the industry as well as in textbooks. Now, loss tangent essentially tells you how the signal level in a board, so when the signal is traveling, dies out as it moves through the board. So this is a measure of how signal loss occurs in signals that are traveling through your board. Loss tangent values typical for FR4, 0.02, and you don't necessarily need to calculate this unless you're working in really long links. But in another video, what I'll do is I'll actually go over to how to use this value to calculate what the expected loss is in your signal level as a signal transitions through a board. And so you can use that to figure out how long your traces need to be or what the limit of your traces should be. If you are working in the high frequency microwave regime, there are alternative materials to just simple FR4 grade laminates. So this is a value for a typical FR4 grade laminate, but an alternative laminate system is PTFE based laminates. And PTFE laminates tend to have about an order of magnitude lower, or about 0.002 loss tangent. So when we say low loss laminate, you're generally referring to PTFE laminates, and they tend to have loss tangent values or around this value. There are a number of factors that determine the loss tangent, and that can be resin content, the tightness of the fiberglass weave in the material. Those factors all combine to give you a loss tangent value. Now, what's also important is the frequency, F, at which these values are quoted. So sometimes you'll see this at maybe about 1 gigahertz. Sometimes you'll see this at maybe 10 gigahertz. Sometimes you'll see it at 100 megahertz. So that's actually also important because it's gonna tell you about where that measurement can be taken as being reliable. In reality, these values actually are different depending on the frequency of the signal in your board. Same thing here with PTFE laminates. They'll generally quote it at a gigahertz. Maybe they'll quote it at 10 gigahertz. Again, you just need to dig into the laminate or into the laminate data sheet. These are three pretty broad values that tell you a lot about your laminate. They tell you about its reliability under high temperature and under cycling. They tell you about how it's going to affect propagation of signals in the board. There's another set of specifications though for laminates, and to see what those specifications are, we're going to look at some examples on the computer. I'm going to actually show you a data sheet, and then I'm also going to show you what I mean when I said earlier, fiberglass weave. So let's get into that. Okay, so what we want to look at now is some examples of what an actual PCB substrate looks like microscopically. And what I'm going to do is show an image from a certain application note that's probably well known. You've probably seen it in search results. And then I'm going to show an actual data sheet to show you exactly what it looks like and where to find the important information and some of the other information that's in the data sheet. So first, I'm looking at this application note from Intel. This is a pretty popular application note, but this application note has some really nice images that show what fiber weave actually looks like. So when I say the fiber weave, what I'm talking about is the actual construction of a PCB laminate material. So in this image here that I have on screen, here in these different images, you can see we've got these long crossing grids of fiberglass. And then all the voids in between these grids are filled in with epoxy resin. And that structure is then hardened and it forms a rigid PCB substrate. The hardening kind of happens during the pressing and stack up construction phase. And then it cures and hardens and then you get your rigid substrate. So different laminate materials will have these different designations, and these numbers on to the left of these images tell you what the different weaves are being used in these different materials. So here, 106, pretty loose weave. You see there's a lot of dark space in between each of these sections of fiberglass. And then here, if I just scroll down, 7268, and 1652, you can see there's very tight weaves. So in general, this tighter weave is going to be much more ideal selection for a high speed design or for a high frequency design. So something that's running in the gigahertz range, something that's running, if it's digital, below 5 nanosecond rise time, in general, you wanna go for 6278 or, you know, similarly tight weaved type of laminate material. The looser weave stuff, you can get away with in lower speed designs. Lower speed logic is fine for that. Lower frequency analog is fine for that. Higher resin content is generally better for higher voltages, but you should always check the breakdown strength of the laminate and don't overgeneralize too much, because laminate manufacturers actually measure things like that to make sure that they're going to be appropriate for different applications. So that's what the fiber weave is in a PCB laminate. And these numbers here, the laminate manufacturer will actually call those out. And so you should, if you need a laminate that has very tight weave, you should make sure to call that out in your materials, in your stack up, when you're actually building your stack up for your board. Make sure to tell that to your fabricator that you need that tighter weave. Just because a manufacturer is out of 7268, it doesn't mean your board is going to fail just because you use 1652. It's slightly less tight, but that's okay. You need to learn to make those judgments for yourself. And of course, you do want to talk to your fabricator about it, because they've likely tested controlled impedance on these different laminates just to make sure that they're actually going to operate the way they claim they will. So next, what I want to look at is an actual data sheet. So I'm just going to open up a data sheet that I have had to look at a number of times. So the material I'm looking at here is a Rogers laminate. Rogers, if you're new to PCB design, you've probably heard the name before. This is a company that manufactures a line of PTFE-based laminates for high-frequency boards. And this particular data sheet, you can just Google it just like I did, and you'll be able to find it. But this is a great example of a typical data sheet that you'll see really for any PCB laminate material, not just for, you know, like a Rogers laminate. And here you can actually see all of the different values, some of them that we were talking about before. And the ones that are really important, again, for you as a design engineer, you can see right here, they've called out dissipation factor. So they haven't used DF, they've just called it the dissipation factor. This tan of delta, that is supposed to tell you that this is the lost tangent. And so you can see here, they have some values called out at 10 gigahertz, specific temperature, 23 Celsius, and at 2.5 gigahertz, specific temperature, 23 degrees Celsius. Here, what's really nice is they've shown the test method. These test methods that are used to measure these things are all standardized in IPC standards, and so they've called that out here. Some other important points, here down at the bottom, let me scroll down, Here, this is the TG value. PTFE laminates have high TG values. You can see here this value is above 280 degrees Celsius. For an FR4 grade laminate, typical fiberglass epoxy resin laminate, it's not going to be this high. So just keep that in mind. Don't be surprised if you're looking at other laminates and you see that. And then there's a number of other values here that are important for maybe for more specialized applications. One thing that I'd like to note down here, because we've talked about this in an earlier video, is something that's more important for manufacturers, but I think it's also important for you to understand as a designer, because a manufacturer may mention this to you at some point. So here in the notes, I'm just going to highlight this note. Here in this note, it says 4 mil laminates have a process decay of this value and are in conformance with IPC 43013A/240. So this /240 refers to the slash sheet. And we talked about that a little bit in an earlier video on four-layer stack-ups. So here, they're telling you, what they're really doing is telling a fabricator which laminates are compatible with each other in terms of replacements and in terms of processes. So here they're saying all the other laminate thicknesses that they provide for this series of laminates, they're /11 and /240 compliant, meaning they are compatible with each other. So they're compatible with other laminates that are also /11 or /240 compliant. So that's what that means. So for you as a designer, you're generally not worried about, you know, hey, am I picking everything /11 or picking everything /240? Generally, what will happen is you'll give all of this information to your fabricator. Your fabricator is going to come back to you and they're going to tell you, well, hey, these laminates aren't compatible, or we don't have this laminate, but we can give you something that's slightly different and gets pretty close to your goals. And you should make sure that you validate the stack up that you want to create with your fabricator so that they can actually manufacture it. The rest of the information in this data sheet, if you'd like, you can go through and read a lot of it. Here you can see the coefficient of thermal expansion. You have some strength values, more important for simulation or if you're doing mechanical testing. Here are the resistivities. These are electrical resistivities that you would measure across a substrate. Again, not so important for you as the PCB designer. Really the important ones we kind of talked about earlier, and then I've called out here in the data sheet while explaining this. So hopefully that helps illuminate some of the information in the data sheet a little bit more. All right, everybody, thanks for watching. Make sure to leave your comments, give us a like, give us a subscribe, help us hack that YouTube algorithm. And make sure, if you have any questions, just leave them in the comments. We'd love to see your questions. Depending on your question, we might make a YouTube video about it. So keep watching this channel and you might just see your question turn into an informative YouTube video just for you. Also, check out the links in the description. We've got a lot of great information on some of the material properties for PCB materials that we've been talking about. Hopefully that'll help you learn a lot more than what we've talked about in this video. If you're looking for a PCB design application and you're still learning about PCB design, maybe you've never taken a board all the way through to manufacturing, go check out Circuit Maker. Circuit Maker is a great tool to help you get started with your first board. It's also a great tool for professionals that just want something that's quick and easy to use. And it's a great tool for people who are still learning PCB design. It will help you learn all of the concepts and the practice of PCB design before you move on to a more powerful PCB design application like Altium Designer. All right, everybody, that's all I got for today. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to call your fabricator.